Dan Graham, Fia Dustin, absent. Jason Redd, Jane Rosenbaum, absent. Guillermo Gomez.
Present.
Gerald Trueheart.
Present.
Lucy Vandenberg, absent. We do not have a quorum. Hi, I'd like to ask Shannon Brady, the director of the athletics, to step up to the podium to do the presentation.
Good evening, everyone. I'm coming for you tonight.
This afternoon, I'm sorry. This evening. To acknowledge our student athletes, because I realize that you all are times very busy and you're unable to come out and see some of them perform and do what they do at their best. So we wanted to bring some of the acknowledgments to you. First of all, I would like to acknowledge a young man. His name is Bryant Sanchez. Bryant, would you come forward? Coach Mo, to come forward, Coach Mohammed Al-Shareen. I'm acknowledging Bryant because Bryant was our Trenton Central High School's representative as the scholar athlete for the state of New Jersey. Earned a GPA of 3.5, and Bryant has done this by taking honors classes and AP classes. Bryant has a scholarship to go to the College of New Jersey, which we will start. And I would like to present to Bryant from the NJSIAA, which is the New Jersey State Athletic Interscholastic Association, I would like to present him with a check for $1,000. Bryant was honored at the Pines Manor in Edison, New Jersey for his academic and athletic accomplishments, and we're so proud that he was our Trenton Central High School representative with a 3.5 GPA. Thank you, Bryant. Some of this to our Coach Mo, which he just completed his first year as being the head football coach. Coach Mo had an average of 2.8 GPA for the entire football team. And I thought that was a great accomplishment also. And so Coach Mo, thank you. Brian, thank you. And congratulations. Good luck next year. Our next acknowledgement will go to our boys track and field team, our spring boys track and field team. I would like to call those young men up, along with their coach, Coach Annie Coleman, the head coach who is Annie Coleman. Would you please come forward, young men? This is our boys spring track and field team. These young men, wonderful young men, they're such great role models. What they did this year was unbelievable. They were the Mercer County champions. Then they went on to South Jersey. This is our first year competing in South Jersey. They went to South Jersey and became the sectional champions of South Jersey. Acknowledge them so they could, you could see them. Most of them are seniors. We only have a few that will be back. And in August, at the next board meeting, they will not be here. They will be away in school. And so we wanted to make sure that they got their just due. and our coach, Annie Coleman, which I'm very proud of. She has done an awesome job working with the young men, and she's going to be working with all of them, young men and young women, next year, and I'm so proud of her. Sam Frisbee. Sam has been working along with us to do a presentation also.
Good evening, Board. Samuel Frisbee from the Mercer County Board of Chosen Freeholders. As many of you know, I'm a fierce advocate for our Trenton Public Schools and for our children that attend these schools, our young men and women that attend these schools. And it's always important to me to make sure that we point our light, shine our light on those young people that have done great things. And so I have two proclamations from the Freeholder Board, because we wanted to make sure that we acknowledge these young people. I came to their awards night last month, and we gave out two scholarships to two students from Mercer County Community College, and my aide talked about giving these proclamations there, but we didn't feel that it was the right place. It wasn't the right venue. We wanted to make sure that Bryant, as well as these track athletes, got there just to their light to shine in the sun on their own. So we wanted to say congratulations, first of all, to Bryant Sanchez, as you come up and receive this proclamation from the Mercer County Board of Chosen Freeholders. And it just reads, whereas Bryant Sanchez has been named the 2016 Trenton Central High School Scholar Athlete of the Year, and whereas Bryant is also the 2016 Delaware Valley Chapter of National Football Association recipient, and whereas Bryant has successfully obtained a GPA of 3.5 or 3.7? 3.65, okay. So we bumped you up, you know, to 3.7. And will be attending the College of New Jersey on full scholarship in the fall of 2016. And now, therefore, be it resolved, the Mercer County Board of Chosen Freeholders hereby deem it an honor to present this proclamation to Bryant Sanchez in recognition of his hard work and outstanding academic and athletic achievement. Bryant, thank you so much for that. And to the track athletes of Trenton Central High School, I'm not going to read all the whereas is, but what I am going to say is that the track teams have a special place in my heart. We never got a chance to run against you guys. I graduated from a school in South Jersey, which is now called Winslow School. And at the time that I was running, we had the fastest high school American in the world at our high school. And we always wanted to run against Trenton Central High School. But you guys were in a different division. We never got a chance to see you guys. And now I understand you're down in South Jersey kicking everybody's butt. So we are so proud of you. We wanted to make sure that we did a proclamation for the full track team. And one of the things that most people just don't recognize is that, you know, when you look at track athletes, and I know that Mr. Grady is here in the building, and I didn't get a chance to attend his retirement dinner the other night, but I do want to say thank you to him for all he's done. But when you look at his athletes, more than likely, I think he has 100% of the young people that have run for him and have bought into his program that go on to college. And track athletes, there's something special about you, because not only do you run as a team, but you're battling against yourself to push yourself further and further, which means that you have to have a discipline that most other people don't have. And so we want to say thank you and congratulations to you, but I want to see you take that discipline further to the next level. How many seniors do we have just standing here? Good. We expect to hear great things from you. We expect to see some things in the paper about what you're doing and at the next level. We want to just say congratulations to you and thank you for being a shining example for the young people in the city of Trenton, because whether you know it or not, they're watching.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon Grady, for your presentation. Thank you so much, and congratulations to all our athletes.
D.A. Graham.
Present.
C. Augustin.
Present.
Jane Rosamond. Guillermo Gomez.
Present.
Gerald Truhart.
Present.
Lucy Vandenberg, absent. Jason Rams. Anaya Guzman.
Present.
We have a quorum.
So the next part of the agenda is something that I think it's done with a heavy heart on behalf of this board. As many of you know, Ball State, a longtime member of this board, as well as a longtime member of our board community. So the board has a resolution, an empowering resolution to the members of the board and also the administration up here and the board director with Rin to speak. We've invited Ms. Millington's family here to receive the resolution and know that we appreciate what their mom did and the contribution that she made as a board member. But also, before she became a board member, as an advocate for students, all students throughout the district. So that is a voice that's going to be missed. I think that as each of us looks at how we do our job up here, and the folks look at how they do their job within the district, we'll kind of take the sentiment that your mom brought to her work and hope that we can live up to the challenge that she challenged each of us to do. So thank you all for being here today, and I'll read the resolution. Resolution Memorial. Whereas for many years, Ms. Millington has been a tireless advocate for special needs students and their families, and whereas Ms. Millington's kindness and expertise in special education matters have been sought by many families in Trenton and beyond, and whereas on January 6, 2012, Ms. Millington was initially appointed to the Trenton Board of Education and served as its president for the 2014-2015 school year, and whereas Ms. Millington served with distinction and pride as a member of the Trenton Board of Education, always keeping the needs of students as her primary focus. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Trenton Board of Education acknowledges with great sadness the loss of Ms. Millington on June 7, 2016, and celebrates her life of service to the students of the Trenton Public Schools.
Denise was probably the member of the board to whom I was the closest. We spoke often on the phone. I visited her in the hospital. I can attest to the fact that she was committed always to seeing that the best happened to our school system. She attended some meetings and she was very, very concerned when it became difficult for her to do so and then finally became impossible. I just want to say that not only is the board diminished by her loss, so is the entire city. It's a terrible, terrible thing to lose someone so young. Thank you.
My heart goes out to the family. I lost my father around this time last year, July 3rd, 2015. And the prayers, I pray for you, continue to pray for your family. That your faith will see you through this time of grief. Continue to pray and to be around family and to know that we care for you, we pray for you, we want you to know you're welcome here anytime to come to share with us. This was Denise's love. The board of Ed, everything was, not everything, but a good portion of her time was spent at the Board of Ed, in schools, at administration building, fighting for the rights of students, advocating for the rights of students. And when she came on the board, she still fought for the rights of students and advocated for them. And that was her love. She came here one session, I believe, and she was ill at the time. And she made her way here with the help of you and the family. And I believe she was in a wheelchair at the time. And that was her commitment. I mean, whatever it took to make a difference for our students and for our community and for our education in Trenton, she did it. She went out of her way. No matter what the odds would be, she went out of her way. So again, it's great for you, and I understand what you're going through, and continue to be in faith and prayer.
I just wanted to say that having the opportunity to meet Denise a few years ago and just her passion for the work, coming on the board as a new member at the time, I really looked to her for her ideas and just her level of passion for the causes. And one of the things I really liked about her that, she was really sweet and loving, but she was no pushover. It was really good to see that and to see her heart. I know that my first convention, Denise sort of got mad at me, and because we needed to have a meeting, but we couldn't have a quorum, and so then later on we got a chance to spend some time together. And I found out she wasn't really mad at me; she was just mad because she just couldn't get her voice in to be heard. So I've always admired that about her, and I will always remember that about her. And you know, to the family, you know, it is a definite loss to the city of Trenton, and it is an opportunity, I believe, for us to honor her by continuing to do the work in the way that she would want us to continue. So thank you for this opportunity to allow me to say something to the family. Thank you.
So as I listened to DA, I met Denise 4 years ago and had the opportunity to actually work very closely with her. She was a member of the curriculum board committee. And so every month we met Jane, Via, and myself and talked about curriculum. So I did get to really, really know her, appreciate her. And you're right, she was no pushover. She used to really pose really tough questions and expected answers. And so for all of that, she did for the children of Trenton, the legacy that will continue for a long time. A lot of times when we're speaking, as she did, we don't know what the years to come will be and what we will be saying about Denise. But I did have a chance to work closely with her and appreciate her. My prayers are with you. Thank you.
I can remember when I first joined the school board, and Denise was mentoring me and giving me advice on how to be a board member. But her advice didn't come through just words, it came through her actions. She served this board well. Even when she couldn't come, she always pushed. Even if she came through the door and she was a few minutes late, she was like, "I'm here, the meeting can begin." We truly are going to miss her. We're going to keep our family in our prayers because you were very important to us. She shared so many stories about you guys when we would travel down to conference together. And I'm thankful that I had the opportunity for her to be not so much just a visual mentor, but a true pillar in the Trenton community. She truly will be missed. I know that special education was very near and dear to her heart. And I know for myself, and I know my fellow board members, we will always keep her in our thoughts as we continue to do good work here for the city of Trenton and our students.
I'm not very good at expressing myself through these difficult times. All I can say is that the day Denise passed is the day my daughter was born, and that will be a day that I will never forget. And what I can tell you with all my heart is that I will try to teach my daughter what Denise showed and displayed at every single meeting, and was her commitment and her passion to the causes that she believed in. So I wanted to thank Denise for her life and for everything that she did for the city of Trenton. Thank you.
So I guess to end on that note, thank you very much for sharing your mom with us and sharing your mom with the city. The one thing that I can say about it is it caught me with a surprise at how sick she was, because she never complained and she was here when she could, and she never let on how sick that she was. So that just speaks to who she was. And so thank you very much for sharing your mom with us. You're welcome to come to the podium and say something if you would like to. If you don't, that's fine too.
Thank you.
So one personal recommendation, item A, abolishing the public interview position. We're pulling personal recommendation, item B, creation of quit public coordinator pay position. And then we're pulling personal recommendation, item D, termination of line 301. So that'll entertain the motion.
So moved.
Second.
D.A. Graham.
Yes.
Fia Gussin.
Yes.
Jane Rosenbaum.
Yes.
Guillermo Lopez.
Yes.
Joe Trueheart.
Yes.
Lucy Vandenberg, absent. Jason Reddick. Motion passed.
Here's your public comment portion of the meeting. First speaker is Kelly Fuller. We have 3 minutes of Fuller.
Good evening. I'm a teacher at Dr. Martin Luther King School, and I was asked to come here and speak on behalf of the staff, parents, and students in opposition of the transfer of Reginald Gilliard from head custodian at our school. The state requirement is 20,000 square feet per custodian. King is 118,000 square feet, which means we would need 6 custodians to adequately service the building. King only has 3 custodians. Grant School has 4 custodians and only 81,000 square feet. And Kilmer, which is the same size as King, has 4. So instead of transferring one of the hardest working custodians in the district, assign him the additional help needed to adequately service the building. If the reason for this transfer is actually due to the building not being serviced as needed, how is transferring a new custodian in that is unfamiliar with the needs of a building like this going to help? The solution is to support Mr. Gilliard with additional help. King School has 43 classrooms, a large cafeteria, a large gym and auditorium, 2 computer labs, science lab, and 2 stories on each side of the building, over 100 staff members, and most importantly, 703 students. This alone warrants the need for the additional help. Mr. Gilliard goes above and beyond the call of duty and has worked for the district for over 20 years. And he is fully dedicated to his profession. He never hesitates to assist the staff, students, and families that belong to King School. It would serve as an injustice to the King community to lose such a valuable person. We developed a petition in order to keep Reggie at our school. We have over 98% of the staff that signed and over 200 parents that signed the petition to keep him at our school. So I thank you for your consideration.
Mercury, their homes had been shaking, but they were excluded from this meeting. But Ms. Grant felt that
that should be going there and represent us. Hope Grant does not represent us. I'm getting sick of her. I don't even know why she's a person. She's a snake.
Ms. Rose Dawkins? But unfortunately, things did not work out. So I am formally stating that I'm going to be filing a formal complaint against Principal Monroe Edwards at Dale Charlie School. I'm going to be filing a formal complaint against Ms. Deja White, paraprofessional at Dale Charlie School. I am formally filing a complaint against Ms. Yolanda, Madam Mayor, employee of Insight Workforce. The complaints will be placed in writing, and I do have some type of legal representation. And we're going to be meeting on this issue. I did want to address this properly to express to him my feelings as to how he handled this whole situation. I do want to state publicly that there are some wonderful, wonderful people in this school district who are in leading positions, but Mr. Edwards is not one. I have never, ever in my life as an administrator or a principal tried to attempt and go a parent to fist fight in front of the school, in front of staff and students during the early morning hours when kids are coming to school, which I have seen him do under the leadership of Ms. Gray last school year. Totally inappropriate. Had I done that, I would be fired. This man, in my opinion, is a tyrant and has a Napoleon complex. And anyone who stands up against him, and I pray for the next vice principal who works with him, she needs to watch her back. Because this individual was smiling in your face, and he would cut your throat as he's doing so. And these are things I would prefer to have said to him to his face in private, but unfortunately, he not choose to meet with me. So I will be making this public. I will be working on this during the duration of the summer, and I will be coming back in here in September, and I will be following up with that for that. And it's sad to say that once again, this school district is losing some valuable people who really advocate for these children, who love these children. And we're burned out and tired. And I see that I'm fighting a lonely battle. A lot of people whom I started off with, who fought for these children, advocated for these children, one by one, go off onto to the wayside. And I'm afraid that I too kind of like joined that line too, because I'm tired. We had people in key positions that were concerned, making over $100,000 a year. They're not advocating for the children. They are more concerned about being okay with the person with whom they may need to work with. You have a person, a principal, who will come down here and call special services and do not move in 101 for her position, whom the parent has consistently complained about. Because this little tiny person here making $100 a day, and he making over $100,000 a day, he was in a power struggle bit. So disregarding the welfare of the parent, and disregarding the welfare of the child, who despised her one-on-one, he was going to show me who was in charge. And other people who had opportunity to do something about it, they went away along with it. All this information will be placed on my name. I will make a point to make sure that you do get a copy of it. And I'm going to be here in September, and I am loud and clear. And I don't care if I never step a foot again in any school in this school district. I love Trenton. I love my children, and that has never stopped. But there are some people that need to go. They really, really need to go. And remember that this is about the children. We got to care about the children. And we have to care about the parents. You can't have one parent call special services and say, I don't want this one-on-one with my daughter because she's too young. And that person is immediately removed. Then you have a Spanish name who barely speak English, consistently going to the guidance counselor, don't know the dish, don't know the system, asking for this one-on-one to be removed from her child because her child was terrified of her. Whom I also witnessed behavior and how this child was treated, who did not speak English. I'm sorry, you're time up. You're not expired, but please.
Okay.
As I stated, I'm going to put all this in writing, and the job you guys are doing, my hat goes off to you, Ms. Grady, and a lot of other principals with whom I've interacted with over the years. My hat goes off to you. Just want y'all to know I love Trenton. I am Trenton, and I advocate and I love my children. I want to end on that note. I'll see you in September. God bless.
Best interests of your employees, and the best interests of this community here in Trenton. Thank you very much. My name is Susan Narby, and I am the NJEA UNISERV representative for three NJEA affiliates in the school district. Once again, I thank the board and the superintendent for the courtesy and willingness to hear my comments on matters before you this evening. I am again asking that you set aside in your personnel transactions under item M, the recommendation for the appointment of the interim assistant superintendent, school support. It's on the agenda this evening. I admit that I feel I'm wasting my time. However, I believe this appointment cannot silently be approved by the board without someone contesting it. It is beyond my obviously limited comprehension how you can withhold the increments for employees who actually hold the required certification for their position based upon their absentee rate, and then appoint someone to the position in question who has a worse attendance record. If you do not need someone who meets the attendance standards set by this position in that position, then perhaps you just don't need the position. It is unbelievable to me that the individual on the agenda was actually the first choice of the selection committee. The last time I addressed this board, I strongly suggested that you should dig deeper and ask the hard questions and demand the evidence to answers you receive. I repeat that suggestion. Have you noticed that on this interim assistant superintendent job description, under qualifications it states New Jersey School Administrator Certificate or eligibility? It is the term or eligibility that jumps off the page. When you approved this job description, you also approved the following job descriptions: Assistant Superintendent of Special Education and Special Needs Services, Assistant Superintendent for Talent Acquisition and Development, Chief Academic Officer, Family and Community Engagement Specialist. If you examine all the job descriptions mentioned, you will find that only one says or eligibility. In fact, this particular job description also cites that a doctorate from an accredited college or university is preferred, and I emphasize preferred, as the individual does not hold that either. So this board would have us believe that none of the other candidates who applied for the position held the qualifications required for the position. Not one had the New Jersey School Administrator Certificate. Not one holds a doctorate. That all of the candidates that were recommended, he is the most qualified. And I can't help but be curious about the attendance record of the other candidates. Hard to believe theirs could be worse. But you have obviously made up your minds and you are going to approve a three-year employee of the district with no previous New Jersey experience who does not meet the advertised qualifications for the position and improve his income over that three-year period by over $30,000. Allow me to put that salary increase into perspective. If you were to give all the members of the Trenton Business and Technical Association, all of the members, a 2.5% salary increase, which is below the county average, but we know Trenton has no money, it would cost this board twice the increase in his salary only, just the increase that you're paying one individual over a three-year period when he does not meet the district attendance expectations or the qualifications posted on the job description. I figure you must be using the savings from the certificated staff increments you withheld based upon their attendance for his salary increase. And just to keep you up to date, there are other concerns. The individual the superintendent has recommended for the position participated in the PD for the secretaries. During that presentation, and I have serious concerns about that, the individual stated that the secretaries need not adhere to the board policies, that there would be circumstances when they're out there and they need to make decisions, and those decisions should be best upon the circumstances of that particular situation. And you should always take into account the parent and the family situation first. And yet, I am currently defending secretaries who have had charges system by your administrators because they did not follow board policies. Okay?
Ms. Nardi, please have any comments.
Thank you. Okay? There was also the problem of reporting, in telling people that reporting under DIFAS and IAIU that they did not need to report it. Okay? So this information went out to the secretaries. And for those administrators who are here, I want you to know that he gave them his cell phone number and told them that they should call him before he calls their, he listens, he, that before they contact their administrators or their principals. Thank you very much, and I know I went over, Jason. I appreciate it.
Fairship 3 minutes.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Frank Carson. As you know, I live across the street from Trenton Central High School, and I'm part of that community. Last week, at Wednesday, I was at the New Jersey SDA board meeting, and while waiting in the lobby for the meeting to start, I noticed an entourage from Trenton Central High School. I asked what the occasion was, and they said that they were there for a design and build meeting. Asked if I could attend that because I'm part of the neighborhood. I look at the school, well, I did look at the school and will look at the school every single day. Asked if I could attend the meeting. I said, no, it's not open to the public. I would like the board to reconsider such a condition and allow the public, especially people from the community, to participate in this type of operation. But are designing the school and building the school, I think it might be the school's benefit, to the community's benefit, and to the Board of Education's benefit, that they get input from the community in when they're building the building and not exclude us, community, from these meetings. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ferris. Just so there's been something new that is, those of you who read our board minutes, which I encourage you to read to make sure that everything that happens here is it's the official record for these meetings. When folks come and present to or ask questions of the board, I know a lot of people in the past have said, well, the board doesn't respond. So what normally happens is we do respond as we can follow up on it, but now we're just going to be part of the official record is when you see these minutes, there's going to be a memo from the superintendent to the board members with each of the comments that are listed there, which will say what the resolution was so you know what happened following those individual comments. So that's the additional thing. The additional follow-up that's there so you know that we're following up and we're taking action on that. So that's kind of as a result. That's something that the board has done, but it hasn't been a little formalized process. So I want to thank Ms. Howard and Ms. Marriott for kind of instituting it that way so now it's part of the official record so that you can follow up. Things that are in response to the personnel or in response to students will be excluded. They'll just see something there just saying received because on those things we can't talk about those specifics. But things like what Mr. Ferris has said, what Mr. Hayes has said, will be included in there in terms of the follow-up and the appropriate things that are done there. So that's just one addition that you can look for as you review our minutes moving forward. The next part of the agenda, I'm going to call up Ms. Rollins, Dr. Rollins, to talk about our literacy program. And I apologize, Dr. Rollins, for taking away your hard-earned doctorate from my...
That's okay.
Thank you for having me.
No problem. I'm Dr. Rollins. I'm the supervisor of language arts. And I would like to briefly give you some update for the Literacy Expo. We did the Literacy Expo started last year. It's from grades 3 to 8, where thousands of students compete in their schools for their school spot. They have to read a book, bring it to life, identify the theme, the plot, the characters. Many of our students come in costumes. They have 3D presentations, and so they're really excited. So all of the schools participated, but this year we had one group of students who went beyond the call of duty. They're third graders, and they're eager. They love to read, and as you can see, their pictures is up on the board. They're from Mott Elementary School, so I would like for their teacher,
want to show you their love of reading, what they learned about George Washington socks, and here's your teacher to introduce them.
Hello, how are you? I'm very excited to be here on behalf of Dr. Conway, our principal, our literacy coach, Ms. Gamone, and myself, Mrs. Franco. I want to introduce these boys, but they are going to introduce themselves. But I do want you to know that they wrote and designed everything themselves. So this is what was really amazing. So I hope you enjoy it, and boys, when you're ready.
Thank you. take us back home?
It should take us back home, because if it took us here, it's the same boat. So instead of Katie rolling away this time, it was Matthew and Tony.
Yes, sir.
And again, the boat was moving in a weird way. Whoa. And it felt another big stop, but even bigger. Oh, are you okay? That's fine. Look, we're back home. Yes. And they all jumped out the boat. Everyone was very happy that they got back home and that they learned more about George Washington, especially Matthew. And Tony was more happy because he got to trade with Katie the sock that George Washington gave her with just a bag of marshmallows. Thank you.
Public school students do read, they comprehend, and they are also writers in their own way. So at this time...
And also, Chris, because these gentlemen, thank you very much for coming back, because you're on summer break, aren't you?
Yeah. Yes. So, with their principal beside me, I would like to present to the young boys from the curriculum team, because they did such a good job, iPod touches. Very important. It provides the reading ability for our ELL learners and And by knowing the students' GRA levels, the teachers could put their students in small group instruction, guided reading instruction, and targeted interventions, as I said earlier. Last year, if you look at the 2014 school data, in the fall, 24.08% of our students were only reading on grade level or above grade level. We put some interventions in place, and we actually jumped in the double digits, which is truly unheard of in reading. So this year, we have increased that now to 37.0% with a 12.9% increase. Our greatest achievement is in fifth grade. We are closing the gap, as you can see, with a 10% increase, and in fourth grade, an 8% increase. To contribute to that is this here. We kept the close reading strategy from K to 12. We did grade level coaching instead of just individual coaching, where the literacy leaders actually coached a whole grade level. We analyzed the data consistently throughout the year, and then we also reorganized the small groups during the winter DRAs. So these things here helped us increase our reading scores and will continue to do so next year. Within that, here's some next steps for next year. We're going to implement phase two of the close reading strategy. We're going to identify early intervention. The literacy leaders will be performing that task, and we'll be doing extra assessments and providing close interventions for those students who are at least one stay nine below. That's imperative for our Trenton students. We're going to streamline tier two and three interventions, and then we're also going to provide PD for our pre-K teachers and our kindergarten teachers so that we have a better transitional plan for those pre-K students who are going into kindergarten. Again, I know that some people may not understand how the jumps must happen in language arts, but to have a double-digit jump is almost unheard of. So I am very proud of the Trenton Public School teachers who worked very hard with their literacy coaches who also worked very hard in their coaching cycle to make sure that Trenton Public School students are reading, and we're just moving in the right direction, and we're going to continue to do so next year. Thank you for your time.
Good evening, President Red. Good evening, Superintendent Fedia. And good evening, board members, parents, students, and community members. Tonight, we're here to present to you our work around our gifted and talented program here in our district. We would like to first outline who we are servicing in our gifted and talented program. And we also would like to present the initiatives that we plan on adding over the next 2 years. And we also want to discuss our next steps, strategies that we want to implement within our gifted and talented program. Mr. Toth is going to talk to you tonight about our AP programs.
So for gifted and talented, just before I get into it, gifted is referring to the academic aspects. How are we servicing our students who are academically above their grade level peers? And talented refers to how we're servicing students who are above and beyond in music, arts, and athletics. So we have a plethora of available AP courses. For science, we have AP Physics 1, Chemistry and Biology. Math, we currently have AP Calculus. AP for Language Arts, AP English Language and Composition, Literature and Composition. For Social Studies, we currently have U.S. History, United States Government. We have in the course catalog for Visual Performing Arts and AP Arts History. We have instrumental music in all schools. Next year, we'll be implementing our Certified Personal Training Program at TCHS West. We currently also have dual credit courses with Rutgers University. I remember I updated you on the progress of those when I did the science data presentation. And at TCHS Chambers, we
level. For next year, we are planning to add 2 AP courses. We also would like to provide the students with the opportunity to take AP statistics for the 2017-18 school year. Now, what gifted and talented programs are we offering at the middle school level? At all of our middle schools, we're offering Algebra 1 at the 8th grade level. We're also continuing to develop and enhance our Donald Shelton Gifted and Talented program over at Kilmer Middle School. We also have instrumental music in all of our schools. And I would like to add that Heth Williams Middle School has added the fact that they are going to be a visual performing arts school at the middle school level. So we are extremely excited about the opportunities the students are going to receive through the arts. Now, what are we planning to add to serve as our gifted and talented middle school students?
So I think last year we got curriculum approved for accelerated math courses for grades 6 and 7, which would have students algebra ready for 8th grade. Next year we're actually going to implement that for the first time. Sue's mentioned how Hedgepeth Williams Middle School is becoming a VPA school. That's going to be through a partnership with Metropolitan Opera House in New York City. We're planning on developing accelerated science courses because we want the students who are taking algebra in 8th grade to have the opportunity to take algebra-based physics alongside. So we're going to have to develop accelerated science courses that will give the students opportunity to develop all the standards they need to be prepared for that. So we'll be developing that next year so that we can implement it the following year.
Also, I just want to add that we are planning to add algebra-based physics in our all our 8th grade classes throughout the district. And I want to add that we're working collaboratively with Dr. Vollins, our supervisor for literacy, to develop accelerated courses in language arts for grades 6, 7, and 8th grade in all of our schools as we continue to develop and fortify our Donald Shelton Gifted and Talented program over at Kilmer Middle School. Now, what do we have for Gifted and Talented for the elementary schools? Currently, we have our instrumental program in all of our schools. So some of our schools have orchestra available to them, some of our schools have band, some of our schools have the chorus available to all of the students. So what are we going to do as far as creating a pathway where our elementary students who are gifted academically, that we're able to capture them at an early age and fortify and enhance those skills? So Mr. Toth is going to talk about that.
So first, we want to develop a committee to plan and create a gifted program for elementary schools, because we currently need one. And we need a curriculum to support that gifted program for the elementary school students. We also need to identify the gifted and talented students. So the gifted students generally are identified by standardized test scores, standardized test scores being about above and beyond their grade level peers within the building they're at, their in-class grades, also performances, so like these science fair projects. Now for identifying the, and teacher recommendations, and for identifying the talented students, the music and dance performances, athletic competitions, and student-made projects, paintings, sculptures, drawings, etc. Parental and/or student recommendations, because parents and students can students can recommend themselves, and parents can also recommend their children for a gifted program.
That is it for our presentation, and we would like to answer any questions that the board may have at this time.
How many students are actually in the program?
Okay, so I have that data for you. As far as our talented program, we have 564 students district-wide who are either in an instrumental program or a band program. We have 730 students who are currently in a choir. We have 75 students over at Visual Performing Arts High School, well, small learning community, that are involved in, I just want to be correct, give me a second. They are involved in dance, okay? So now we have 94 students who are involved in drama, and I think we saw some of those students perform for you during our board meetings. We have currently 537 students who are either enrolled in AP courses, dual credit courses, our socially responsible engineering program, algebra 1 courses at our middle school level, and students who are attending the Donald Shelton Gifted and Talented program at Kilmer.
Is there a way we can identify these students sooner than what we're doing right now?
Absolutely. That is why we are developing a committee. We already had meetings with stakeholders, TEA, in particular, to discuss how do we push down at the elementary level? How do we identify quickly who these students are that need to be serviced in our gifted and talented program? I'll give you an example very quickly. Superintendent Feria and myself, we were analyzing our Lexia data, and we noticed, well, you know, there are some second grade students who are reading at a fifth grade level. So what we said, and this is something that I shared with both the principals that I had an opportunity to talk to today, we have to look at our data. We have to see whether it's DRA, whether it's Lexia, etc., and we have to identify those students who are reading beyond their grade levels. And then we have to ask ourselves, what is it that we're going to do to service their intellectual needs? So that is something that we are extremely passionate about, and we want to have all our stakeholders involved in making the decisions as far as what type of gifted and talented programs we're going to be offering our students at the elementary level.
Thank you.
I'm just really happy to see the, not really a question, but more of a comment, just really happy to see the commitment of our gifted and talented program. I remember 2 years ago, we started the gifted back in the city of Trenton in our academic, as well as sports, as you mentioned, gifted and talented, two different aspects of our students' achievement. But I am so happy and thrilled to see that our babies and our young people can achieve at the highest level in our district. They can, the sky's the limit in terms of where they can go as we continue to fund and continue to promote and continue to build our gifted and talented program. And I'm happy to say that we made that commitment as a board, and I'm happy that the superintendent, our previous superintendent, Dr. Grant, as well as Ms. Feria, as well as our team here, has continued in that focus to help our students reach their full potential. And so I just thank you for your help and your support, both of you and of course all the teachers and administrators and the students alike who are involved in the program. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just want to make a comment as a member of the curriculum committee.
Yes.
I am aware of what the curriculum actually looks like, and it's wonderful.
It is.
It would compare favorably with anyone anywhere. So
thank you. So the year has come to an end. And the academic year for the students and the teachers. And I really wanted to just take this opportunity as we close the school year to thank all of the many, many, many stakeholders. Everyone that's in this audience, our PTO president, the presidents of all the different unions, the mayor's office, the principals, all the community members, assemblymen, Kushiara actually gave to support the literacy expo $1,000 of his own, from his own checkbook, to ensure that we had the prizes and that we had everything that we needed to have the expo again.
And that's just one example of others. NAACP education movement has been working with us all year since last August, looking at data, problem solving, and just having conversations about how do we make it better. So I really wanted to thank everyone, because it takes everyone for all that has been accomplished this year. It's been a year of transitions, and we've had to make a lot of difficult decisions. It has not been easy, but I always say that great things are not easy to come by. We had four areas of focus, early literacy being one of them, ensuring that the graduation rate would continue to rise was the second one. Really tackling, and I say really attacking, chronic absenteeism and using data to really inform every decision we made. And then maintaining and building even greater our arts and music program. And I really feel very proud of all the work that everyone has done, because what we know is that at 17 out of the 20 schools, chronic absenteeism was reduced. This week I will be giving the trophy to the school with the lowest chronic absenteeism, a school that actually reduced it more than half, and it was very deliberate. Last August, we gave every school the actual names of the students who had chronic absenteeism over several years. And they checked and connected every single child to make sure that we were giving them whatever it was that they needed and just raising awareness. And that awareness actually worked. We also are very proud last week. We attended, many of us around here, and some of you out there, I saw Darren Green there last week, and many of the other, Michael Goodman, all the people that are in the audience have been coming out to the many, many closing ceremonies for the elementary schools, for the middle schools. And we had three amazing high school graduations. And we've been counting heads all year, looking at the data, making sure that the students are receiving the courses that they need, doing the transcript analysis, evaluating what's missing. And I am sure that when the official data comes in, we will be showing an increase in the graduation rate. The students did a phenomenal job. Hope Grant, Principal Mark Hoppe, Ronald Edwards, all really did a phenomenal job with those graduations last week, and I really wanted to mention that, because yes, it takes a lot to ensure that those students not only graduate in March, but they are actually prepared for college and career, and that they actually have that vision for their future, and that they are very social and responsible. So I'm very proud of those students. The numbers were a lot, large numbers. We shook over 600 hands over 2 days. And I know that we're going to hear about all the great things that Brian Sanchez, for example, gave his speech. And it was so articulate, it was so eloquent, and many, many, many more. I mean, there were definitely moments of pride as we watched those students march. So I close, I do want to make one point of clarity before I close. The SDA meeting identifies who attends at the community and who is represented. This is not something that any principal of the school, whether it's an SDA project at this time or in the future, does. It's an SDA meeting, and they're the ones who identify who attends the meeting. I want to just be sure to give that point of clarity. And then in closing, I want to thank President Jason Ray and all of the board members for your amazing vision and support as I served as interim superintendent since October the 5th. It's been a joy working with you and for you, and for the students of Trenton. I am looking forward to a very busy summer. I'm sorry to tell you, we have a lot of retreats that we're going to be attending. Because the summertime is not downtime for any school district. Summertime is actually reflection, rejuvenate, but plan. We have a lot of planning to do because although we are happy with the achievement levels going up in its positive trajectory, I would say, as Martin Luther King said in his speech, I Have a Dream, he speaks of the urgency of the moment, he speaks about the urgency of now. But then he says in a paragraph after that, no, no, we are not satisfied. So I say exactly as Dr. Martin Luther King said in 1967, no, no. We're celebrating accomplishments, but we are not satisfied. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you for coming. I know that for a lot of you, the school year ended last week, but we're into our summer session. First thing that I want to, there's a few people that I want to give a special recognition to, and my first one is Karen Agnabi. So I see her over there. Karen has been with us since last summer via a grant from Bristol-Myers Squibb, and I talked with Jane, and we're not sure if she's going to be continuing with us, but I think that what she's done to help our buildings be safer in terms of the chemicals we use for cleaning, the green ways in which we do our business. Some people think that green costs more, but Karen's been able to show us things that cost less, cost the same, but are providing a better environment for our students, for our staff, and are just overall better for our planet. So I think that the feedback that she's provided to us as a district has been valuable, and I'm hoping that we'll figure out a way to continue our relationship moving on into next year. But I wanted to say thank you very much and give special recognition for all your work. So thank you very much, Karen. Formula out last week that will
state, the city of Trenton. In terms of there's not a lot of specifics there, but if you just read the way that the proposal reads right now, there's a lot of concerns here on behalf of Ms. Howard, on behalf of the superintendent, on behalf of myself. So you all know conversations have already been had with the Education Law Center, with our elected officials, and will continue to be had at that level because as it is right now, I don't know how we can survive as a district. We had a rough year, and I know all of you have been here with us, we had a rough year this year with flat funding. So if we have a reduction, I don't know what that means, and so we're gonna continue to work with our folks because that's not a way that we can survive. So just so you know where we are, we stand unified, and I think our comments reflected it, but I wanted to say it here. We stand unified with our seven members, our senator, our mayor, and I think they will, and we're gonna move forward and work, and also Ms. Howard worked closely with David Schauer with the Educational Law Center, and we'll continue to work with them as well because we consider them partners. They were the original lawyers from the original lawsuits, so we're gonna continue to work with them on that front. I think the board is going to continue to work this summer as well with the superintendent mentioned. We've got at least one, probably two retreats lined up. Also, we recognize and we appreciate the superintendent stepping in the pinch hit and serve as our superintendent. She's done an amazing job. So please recognize the superintendent. And the superintendent, she's graciously agreed to stay with us until we're able to bring in our next one. So I think that Dr. Brand was going to mention some things, but please stay tuned because that process continues and we want you to be a part of it. The last thing I want to do is to give a shout out at the beginning. I want to give a shout out to some of my favorite people now. And so to Larry and Dwayne, I know your folks are getting ready. They do an amazing job on our buildings when we get out of them. And so I know that this is a lot of people take breaks during the summer, but your folks go in there and this is your hardest time. So you are appreciated during the year.
Start off by saying thank you for allowing me to serve on this board, and being a representative for the students at my school, as well as all the other schools around, is a really big honor to me because I feel like it gives us a better opportunity to be heard and being more a part of something bigger than just our own education, but being able to help other people's education as well is very, like, it hits me a lot because I really do hope everyone excels in life, and being able to, you know, maybe be a part of making something bigger is really just something big to me. Thank you, guys.
So just want to piggyback on our president, Jason Fred's comments. The city of Trenton has started, and we have been approved for the United States Department of Agriculture Summer Food Service Program. Today was our first day of operations. The city of Trenton has 20 sites that are open to the community. The sites are listed. There's banners that are hung throughout the city of Trenton that list the 20 sites. There are over four locations per ward. The Trenton Public Library is one, and the other 19 are local parks throughout the city. Also, we do have a summer camp and a park program for Trenton residents. The cost of the program is free. We only ask for them to pay $70 to offset the cost of trips. And that is a program Monday through Friday from 9 to 3. We look forward to servicing all of our residents this summer. Thank you.
I think I'll go before Red True Heart. I heard about you at graduations. It is indeed a pleasure to be at a board meeting where we can actually laugh about something and to celebrate our students. This is why we do what we do. This is why I know that I'm here. All the complaints that come to us, we take very seriously. We do ask questions of the administration. We ask for feedback, we ask for follow-up, we ask for follow-through, and sometimes we'll ask for feed front that we want to know certain things. I think it's important that you know, besides the fact that I cut my hair, it is the goal of this board to create a school district that all of the city and surrounding areas can be proud of, and that we are ultimately a beacon for other programs. However, we keep getting kicked in the stomach or other places that we don't want to get kicked. As we continue to try to move forward. And then the system tries to trip us up. But we're gonna do everything that we know how to fight for our learners and to make sure that we do what's in our power to do the right thing. With that said, I want to give an update about the superintendent search. We have request for proposal went out again. We only had one firm that answered the call, and it was the firm we had last time. So we asked the administration to revise the proposal, and so as of June 27th, the request for proposal will be issued again throughout different vehicles to try and get organizations or search firms to submit proposals. That deadline is July the 18th. We did have one proposal that came in, but it came in after the deadline. So we could not receive that proposal, which was the other reason why we had to revise the proposal and open the RFP again. So We are in the process of trying to move forward with the search. We're working diligently with the administration to make sure that we're doing everything in our power to get the right superintendent for this district. With that said, I want to thank all of my colleagues up here and my colleagues from the administration that we worked with for making this year one that was fun and exciting, and looking forward to the challenge for the coming year. And just want to reiterate that we will miss Denise Millington and her contributions to this board. Thank you very much.
Just to clarify, Board Member Graham, the response date for the RFP was extended to July 29, just to ensure a much broader response from the various venues in which we'll advertise.
Thank you.
Mr. President, I am in the general public. I want to share with you that I am the chairman of the SDA committee. We do not have a meeting this month. This is the committee that was created by this board. We have it on a monthly basis here in this very room. But in March, on the recommendation of the SDA, SDA CEO, we postponed the monthly meetings until September. There has not been a meeting only at the last board meeting. They were here and made a presentation. If there was a meeting, it was not ours, and we have no control over the SDA. Now, with that said, I do believe it is crucial, it is important that as we move forward, we do it as a community, and its input is imperative to the proper development of our school district, of our community, of our city. At the monthly board meetings, one of the things that I value most is that it's community input. We listen to what you have to say, and because what you're going to say is going to change, or could change dramatically, the way we want to move forward. Now, it is an opportunity for the public and for the speaker to speak their minds, to share their concerns, to share their wants, their needs. But throughout this entire school year, from time to time, I have heard what I believe to be an abuse of your freedom of speech when it comes to insulting directly and publicly members of our staff. I'm the SDA chairman. You have something to say about the way we conduct our business, say it to the board, say it to me, this is the policy, say it to the presiding officer. Don't hide behind your right to speech while insulting members of our staff. Say it to the president, I'm sure he can take it. As the chairman, I sure can take it. I yield back, Mr. President. Thank you.
I got 2 minutes now. I'm not going to try and take real long, but this is important, right? We're talking about our babies, our children, and our students, and I'm so proud of our student rep. Last board meeting, if you were working and you're certainly a student, but you're working, taking care of your family and doing the things you do to for education and your lifestyle and everything. We missed you, but we had two of your fellow students here that came to the podium, and they were the top two students, I believe, in the district that were graduating and going on to these great colleges, like Morehouse College, like where I went to school. But they actually got going to Morehouse, one of the other great colleges in the state, as well as around the country. And they brought some great points to us. And one of the points was they wanted representation. So, and I mentioned to them that we had a student rep that wasn't here for tonight, that was excused for tonight. And so I am so proud. I am doubly proud. We are doubly proud that you are on board as a student rep that can speak to the voice of our students, you can speak to us, students is wonderful. So I thank you for being here and continue. Anything you need, we're here to help. Anything you need, we're here to help you. Anything, don't be bashful, don't be shy. If there's something to understand, just give it to us. We think you get mad, you just have to get mad. All right. The other thing is I wanted to just give a shout out to Thea. What a super job on the Food Summit. I mean, she put her heart, her soul, and everything she had into the Food Summit. She had local, state, and county representation here from all the different food service agencies and governments within our local county and state government to provide summer feeding to all of our students. Not only all of our students over the summer, but 365 days a year, the committee is working to feed our students and give them nutritious meals, make them educated. And what happens, you know, you can't eat, you can't say. You can't think, you can't learn. So a shout out to my sister. Keep doing what you're doing. The other thing is, two important things I think are important. One is our summer programs for our babies, for our kids, right? We have our summer high school program, our 9th through 12th grade program over at Hanover, ODI Twilight. I still call it that Twilight, but our high school 9th through 12th grade summer program. The second thing is we have our Rising K-12 Early Learning Program. If you haven't registered, Rising K-2, so it's on the first, second, and third grade in September, we have a program to help our students throughout the summer, right, learn and continue to learn over the summer. And so we have other programs all across the city, but in terms of the board, those are the programs that we have. Registration ends very, very soon, I believe the end of this month. Registration in. So if you haven't registered your kids, please register your students. It's on our website. Take a look at the website. All the information is there. Get your kids in a good summer program. Get our high school students to get credit. We've got some great things going on. The other thing, the last thing I want to mention, actually one more thing. Family Extravaganza, August 26th from 10 to 2. We've got some great partnerships coming. We're reaching out across the aisle with our FACE committee. And this is a double team on that, on this comment. TASS. The Trenton Area Soup Kitchen has come on board with about 400 or 500 book bags to partner with us. Also, partnership with Trenton has come on board to partner with book bags. I'm not sure how many they're going to partner and bring on board. And Mike at the PTA, PTA, as well as Concerned Pastors, Mark Roach, as well as TASS, Mercer Street Friends, partnership with Trenton, have been coming to our committee meetings and sharing with us as a committee how we can partner better with our city, and with our community, and with our community partners, both faith-based and nonprofit-based or community partners, right? So we are coming, we're reaching out like we said we would. Every month we have one of our community partners come and share with us the great things they're doing in our city. And those partnerships are flourishing. And we're gonna team up and really begin to do great things in our city to build upon what we've already done, but continue to do great things in our city. So I just want to give a shout out to those organizations and others who are involved in our programs here in the city, but our babies and our students come first. And again, thank you, shout out to our student rep, and I'm done.
Now, are there any more discussion on the consent agenda, or I'll share a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
D.A. Graham?
Yes.
I'll second.
I still say yes.
Okay, D.A. Graham? Yes.
Fia Gussin?
Yes.
Jane Rosenbaum?
Yes.
Guillermo Gomez?
Yes.
Gerald Trueheart?
Yes.
Lucy Vandenberg, absent. Jason Redd?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Now, I'll start to entertain a motion to approve board policy 2624, grading policy and procedure. I will now read the executive session resolution. Whereas the Public Media Act, codified NJSA 10.4-6, exequitur, permits the exclusion of the public from a meeting under certain circumstances, and whereas the Trent Board of Education is of the opinion that such circumstances presently exist, I think it is follows. Any pending or anticipated litigation or contract negotiations to which the board is or any common party, any matter falling within the attorney-client privilege, to the extent the confidentiality is required to preserve attorney-client relationship, and allow the attorney to exercise his or her authority as a lawyer, matter, memorandum of agreement, the Trent Professionals Association, board agreements, SSA, risk and personal matters related to the appointment, termination, employment, term of conditional appointment, evaluation, performance, or promotion, or disciplining of any specific prospective public officer, employee, or current public officer, employee, employer, appointed by the public body, unless all individuals who can be adversely affected request in writing that the request be accepted at public meeting. Superintendent's evaluation 2016-2017 contracts of employment with superintendent, assistant superintendent, and business administrator. Now therefore be it resolved that the Trenton POA County Commissioner, State of New Jersey, having an executive session will be held on June 27, 2016 for the statutorily permissible purposes indicated in the resolution. Be it further resolved that action may be taken by the board on the convenience of the session, and be it finally resolved that the minutes of the executive session for regarded subject matter shall be disclosed to the public at a later date, and to the extent that the same is not prejudicial to the interest of the parties involved, no longer have a public interest or does not endanger any individual right to privacy. All those in favor of adjourning to accept the session, so we'll have to say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We're in session. For those of you that are not going to be able to come out to that session, have a happy summer, and we'll see you later.